Welcome to I May Be Wrong.
I don't know what this world is coming to,
but I don't think so. We're broadcasting from the greater Nashville area,
the home of country music,
beyond the borders of political correctness and identity politics. Facts and faith are our demarcations. Truth lights our path.
Here's the Barry White of podcast radio,
the venerable Alfonso Ashworth.
Well, welcome to another exciting episode of I May Be Wrong, But I Don't Think So. Of course, I want to welcome you to the show. We got a great show for you this hour. We got a lot that's going to be happening in the next few weeks and the few days. Of course, there's always something to talk about when it comes to the church. There's always something to talk about when it comes to what's going on in your state concerning the church. A lot of the states are enforcing these draconian type rules upon the church, upon the citizens. Washington State is now demanding that all restaurants that are going to reopen, they have to keep a log of their customers. They have to do all these almost impossible tasks of screening every customer for COVID-19. They have to do all these things in order to be able to operate their business. This pandemic has shut down the country, but it is harming the church maybe even more so. My guest is coming on this hour. And by the way, I want to welcome everyone to the chat. If you got something you want to say, just chat with us. You can do it through Facebook Live. You can also do it through YouTube if you're listening on YouTube. And if you're on my website, go to I May Be Wrong, But I Don't Think So. You can also chat with us as well through the website. So we're covering all the bases. And if you miss a show live, you can catch us in the podcast on all major podcasts. And of course, you know, I get recommendations all the time on who should be on the show, who may fit the show, and I try to fit my guests to the show. I don't just go out and grab anyone. And this person, Dale Walker, who is Tennessee State Pastors Association Network. I'm sorry. He'll be able to tell you all the details when I get him on here. He was someone recommended by a very dear friend that also helped support the show. And I reached out, and he was willing to come on. He's going to talk to us today about what's going on in the state of Tennessee and what's going on with the church and the network that he's associated with. And then we're going to also open up the conversation and talk about some of the other things that are going on as well in churches, maybe in your state. But I want to welcome to the show, and I'm very honored to have on the show, of course, Dale Walker. Dale, welcome to the program, sir.
Thank you to be on the program with you today. I appreciate the opportunity and invitation. I appreciate the confidence that your friend had to share the information about the Tennessee Pastors Network with you. Honored to be here with you today.
Well, I tell you what, and this is a 30-minute segment, and I'm going to give you all the time that you need to tell us about the network. What is the network, and what does it do, and how is that important to the citizens of the state of Tennessee?
Tennessee Pastors Network, we're part of the American Pastors Network. American Pastors Network is the umbrella, basically, over the different states where we have chapters with the American Pastors Network. I serve as president and the co-founder of the Tennessee Pastors Network. We have been in existence and been going, I believe, since actually 2015. So we've been working in the state for about 5+ years. I was going to the Capitol even before that until we were able to be associated with the American Pastors Network. We're an entity that we don't charge. There are no fees. This isn't about money. You know, oftentimes as pastors and as organizations, we hear, well, your organization, you know, it's all about money. Listen, I don't take a salary from my church. I don't take a salary from the Tennessee Pastors Network. I work for a living, and I make this statement. I pay my own freight. I pay my own expenses, and I work for a living. And there are a lot of bivocational pastors out there. and there are a lot of other pastors that are full-time pastors out there, that sometimes they feel like an island to themselves when they're dealing with the cultural issues and the cultural battles that we face today as a pastor. And we come along beside of them and we'll speak a biblical worldview. We'll speak a biblical worldview on issues like abortion. We were involved in the drag queen story hour situation up in Cookeville, Tennessee. One of the things that I have an absolute intense hatred for is I hate what I call wicked liquor. Liquor controls much of what goes on in the Tennessee state legislature. The liquor lobby is extremely powerful. All you have to do is go look and see how much money that your legislator, whether state rep or state senator, takes from the liquor lobby. And then you will see why they vote for every wicked liquor bill. And what? As pastors, we deal with these issues at the church house much differently. But these are things that we deal with as far as the Tennessee Pastors Network. Anything that rears its head that we're in opposition to, we're going to speak out for or against.
Well, and I, of course, you on the ground, and if I may say it, you are on the front line when it comes to going to these events that you just named some. You go to the events and you make yourself known, you make your presence known, and you also bring with you the force behind you of the Pastors Network. But what does that do in terms of what we're dealing with today with what's happening with this pandemic? How did we find ourselves in this situation when it comes to the power of the state versus the power of the church? What in particular are you been doing, and what is it that we can do as people, as Christians? Well,
when this issue first came out, I dropped a news release regarding Shelby County. Shelby County addressed the houses of worship in their health department mandate, directive, whatever that you want to call it. I called on the governor, and this was right before Easter. This is when they were telling us, you can't go to church, you can't have Easter Sunday, one of the most important times of when we celebrate the resurrection of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And I called upon the governor, I emailed his office, I addressed his office, I asked Governor Bill Lee, who I've been referring to him, that he's acting like a king, and he thinks he has a monarch.
That's
and
right.
I met with the governor. I like the governor. I just don't like some of the things that he is doing. And I respect him as my governor, but I do not appreciate when state leaders end up acting as king and the state legislature sets back and very few are actually calling out these things. But I call this out as a concern as the president of Tennessee Pastors Network. When you have a health department, they're not a legislative body. And for them to threaten houses of worship with closure, I have a real issue with this. Knox County, about 2 weeks ago, they came out and they addressed the churches and they put out a memorandum, whatever you want to call it. They put out rules that a church, it was recommended that they not sing, they could not do communion.
Right. Yeah. Oh, wow. I mean, I didn't really think about that one, Dale, about singing and about, some of the traditional things that a church would do, you no longer can do.
And this is absurd. And I've got pastors that are contacting me, that are calling me and saying, hey, what do you think we should do? What can we do? There's just a massive amount of concern out there. And I think a lot of the underlying factor that you've got governments that are overstepping their bounds with the houses of worship is the fact that we don't pay any taxes. Okay, we're not like big liquor.
Right.
We're not like the payday loan industry that has all of their lobbyists down there that pays a bunch of money. When I go down there, I'm not slinging around a big checkbook.
Right.
I'm not doing that because number one, we don't have that kind of money. And so when we're as a church, we don't pay any taxes. So do they really care at the end of the day whether we exist or not? A lot of them don't. Matter of fact, a lot of them would like to shut up the church because it's the church that gives the opposition to them many times for their drifting away from the Constitution.
But what about Bill Lee? That's, you know, because Bill Lee, when he first came out as running for governor, he really pictured himself as pro-Christian, pro-church. And now he's extended this executive order to June the 30th, which gives him more power to do some of these things that you're talking about. And I'm afraid that the American people don't realize just how much freedom they've allowed to be snatched away from them because of something called a pandemic that we've never done in the history of the world, basically, definitely not the history of this country. How did the church set back and not only allow some of the things that you're just talking about with the liquor lobbies, the porno lobbies, the gambling lobbies, all these different groups have lobbied and have taken over our industries and now are proclaiming the church to not be essential, that the church should be set on the back burner while the liquor stores are allowed to operate, while some of these other industries are allowed to operate freely, the churches are being punished. Why is that and what can we do? We need to find a way to get either people mobilized, to get more active in not only in their churches, but out in the streets like you're doing.
Well, thank you for that. I appreciate that. I mean, I believe that we're reaping what we have sown. As the church, we have set back and we have let the liquor lobby, the payday loan lobby, and all the other lobbyists down there, they go down there to the Capitol and they have power. They have control. They get the people elected that they want elected because they give the money to their campaign funds.
Exactly.
And so you get you just get favors going back and forth. As far as the church being declared essential and non-essential, Governor Bill Lee, when I preached out there in front of the liquor store, his campaign, his office did respond to us when we preached in front of the liquor store on Good Friday, right before Easter. Okay.
Right.
Here we are in front of the liquor store at Lebanon, Tennessee, and we're standing out there saying, okay, the liquor store is essential. I mean, the cars were coming in, people were coming in all over that day.
Exactly.
No social distancing, no limiting the number of the store, but yet he's telling me and my church, I need to limit the number of people to 10. Listen, you can tell where the power is and where the money, and they literally follow the money. And I'm going to go back. When Governor Lee's campaign, when he first came out that he was going to run for governor, his campaign called me as president of the Tennessee Pastors Network and asked me if I would meet with him. Of course, we had a great meeting with him, and we had prayer together. But the first question I asked him was, "Are you going to take liquor lobby money for your campaign?" And based on what I've seen, he did take liquor lobby money,
apparently
alcohol. But asking that question, he said, "Well, I've never really thought about that. I don't know. He said, "I'll get back with you." Well, he never did answer that question for me. That should have been a red flag to me. But when I have a real problem on the fact of the essential and the non-essential, when they're not putting any restrictions on the liquor store, they're continuing to sell the state lottery tickets. Of course, they got to have the lottery money coming in. Payday lenders, man, they're rolling. But the church, back to the church, the reason this is we've set back and we have let this happen. We as the church, there are enough pastors in the state of Tennessee, if they would get fired up, and it may take civil disobedience, and I'm not talking about violence, I'm just talking about civil disobedience to stand up for our God-given rights.
And that's at the heart of the matter. That is at the heart of the matter. Is our God-given rights, and what are we going to continue to allow that's going on in places like Washington State, that's going on in places like Michigan, that's going in places like Virginia, and a lot of these, I don't want to get too political, but a lot of these blue states are taking advantage of this pandemic, and they're imposing their will, and the church is being shut down. In some of these places, it's almost impossible to conduct a service in some of these places where you have to do all these things first. You have to jump through this hoop and this hoop and this hoop, then jump this hurdle, this hurdle, this hurdle. What do you think on the broader scale nationally is happening in some of these places, and why are people in these states, like you said, out marching on the capitals? And it's going to get even worse as we move on into summer, where more and more people can get out. What do you think about what some of these other states are doing?
Well, I like Matt Staver with Liberty Council. I appreciate their organization. And Matt Staver said this. He said, in the land of the free, pastors and churches should never have to fear arrest or sanction for attending worship service in church.
Right.
And in Liberty Council, they're the ones that are representing the Romanian churches that are in Illinois. Now, the Romanian pastors, man, they've lived under the heavy hand of oppressive government. They know what it is, and they don't want to go back there again. But preachers and pastors and men and women of God in America are going to have to get rid of the talking points. And as I mentioned there, it's not just the pastor that ought to be standing up for our religious God-given rights. It ought to be every family. It ought to be every man and woman in that church. And we're going to have to stand faithful to what our core sincere beliefs, what we state that they are. The Oregon churches out there, I like what some of the Oregon churches said. They said, if we die, then we're going to heaven. If we want to take the risk to worship, then it's on us. And right. That's right. It is on us. We should have the right. Jack Roberts in Kentucky, Maryville Baptist Church. I appreciate this man. I have friends that know him well that attended the church. When the state troopers actually came to his church on Sunday a few weeks ago, took down the license plate numbers of the people that attended the church service and put placards on their car, and some of them, the health department, went to their houses, I believe, and placed them under a quarantine, which was like putting them under house arrest. Did we ever think in America that we would see these type tactics? I mean, these type tactics would make Red China proud of Kentucky. And we should get upset. We should get righteous indignation when we have governors that overstep and overpressure the people of God. And when in Kentucky, the abortion clinics are open, the liquor stores are wide open. It's the same thing. Wickedness, as I put a video out the other day, wickedness is going wide open, but the government wants to shut down the churches. And this is egregious. I mean, it's absolutely egregious. And as God's people, we cannot sit back and let this happen. And our state reps and our state senators in the state of Tennessee, where are they at? Where are they at? There's very few of them.
Apparently they're in hiding. I don't know. I mean, and I've asked some of the same questions that you've asked. Matter of fact, most of the time when politicians address me, I generally ask them, don't tell me what you're going to do, tell me what you're not going to do. Because that's where the devil is normally in the details, just like you said about the liquor industry. They normally will shy away from answering those questions because there are huge dollars in that money that can come into their campaigns to get them in office, and it's nearly impossible to root them out of there. Once they get in, they can pretty much do what they want to do. Of course, we got just a few more minutes. One, I want you to tell the audience, how can they get in touch with you and your network, and what's the easiest way to find you?
They can look us up, tnpastors.net. You can type in my name, Pastor Dale Walker, Tennessee Pastors Network. You'll see where we've dropped news releases. We've made media on different things. You can type in the American Pastors Network. We have a Stand in the Gap radio show that I encourage people to listen to every day. Brother Sam Royer and several of the others that are involved with the American Pastors Network does a great radio show on a daily basis. That's Stand in the Gap radio, and that comes on at 11 o'clock Central Standard Time, 12 o'clock Eastern Standard Time daily. There is and then they have a weekend show also. I think we're on about 600 or 700 radio stations with the American Pastors Network. So there's constantly biblical worldview out there, pastors. If you're wanting information about really what is going on, and you're not going to get a bunch of spin, you're not going to get a bunch of a denominational rhetoric, because this is not what we're about. It doesn't really matter what denomination you are. We're non-denomination. We want to work with any pastor out there, any church that has a concern. You're welcome to call me. My cell phone number, my personal cell phone number is 931-260-5301. And that is my that's my cell phone number. You can email me at dawalker00@blomand.net. That's dawalker00@blomand.net. We would be glad to assist you. Pastors, if you want to be part of the Tennessee Pastors Network, just let me know, and we will keep you apprised of the concerns. But right now in your state, Pastor, if I were you, I would encourage you to get on the phone and call your state rep. My state rep, Paul Sherrill, I've not heard a peep out of him. My state senator, Paul Bailey, I've not heard a peep out of him publicly saying, hey, we need to step up to the plate. We need to do something about what's going on in Tennessee. I have heard things from Bruce Griffey and others, a few others out there. And we've got to step up to the plate. Pastors, churches, people of faith. Because what we're going up against today is the power of darkness, and our weapons certainly are not carnal, but they're mighty to the pulling down of strongholds, and there are a lot of strongholds out there, and if we want to keep our religious liberty and we want to continue to hold our sincerely held beliefs, it's time we stand up, it's time we show up, it's time we speak up, because if not, we are going to lose our greatest liberty that we have, our right to worship and freedom.
Yes, and that's why that, you know, not just the fact that it's constitutional, it's the Bill of Rights, it is also inalienable. That means it was given to us by a higher power than the government. It was given to us by God. So we cannot continue to allow these oppressive, draconian institutions with large sums of money to buy us off, because that's what they've done with these bailouts and these stimulus and all these things. They just bind people to stay, to keep their mouth shut. Don't say anything. Just take your money and go away. And it's drop in the bucket compared to what they're spending to, matter of fact, to godless institutions like Planned Parenthood.
Yes.
Nancy Pelosi, they're trying to structure a new $3 trillion stimulus bill, and a lot of that money is going to some of these things like Planned Parenthood. It's just, they cleverly are crafting these legislation so it's hidden and people will not go and read it. You know, when something is 65,000 documents and whatnot, most people are not going to go and try to read all of that. But of course, just keep in mind, of course, what you're saying with the Pastors Network, with other things like the show here. I may be wrong, but I don't think so. Other people who are out there on the front line, who are out here fighting. This is about we the people. It's That's about right. We the people, not we the government. And we have to continue to fight back. And of course, you got about 2 minutes. Tell us what you think about what's going on right now with the corona situation and what's going on in your mind with where we're headed for this continued shutdown.
Hey, I get it. It's real. I understand that it's real. We certainly don't want anybody to get sick. We've been having church at our church, and we're going to continue to have church at the church that I pastor. And I believe it's up to every individual church, not the government. It's up to the people of the church. Let the people be the people. Let them make the decision. I like what George Washington said. He said, the time is now near at hand, which must probably determine whether Americans are to be free men or slaves. Liberty, property, life, and honor are all at stake. Upon your courage and conduct rest the hopes of our bleeding and insulted country. 1776, George Washington. And I would say to you pastors and you people out there that are listening, what are you going to do? You can sit on your couch and you can stay at home and you can lament all the time about what's going on. But it costs you money to get in your car when things open up to go to the legislature. It costs me money. I have to pay my parking bill and right. expenses like that. But you can make a difference, and one voice can make a difference. And pastors, you better start talking about these issues in your pulpit, because I assure you there are people in your pews that want to hear what's going on, and they want to hear an up-to-date report on what is going on in our culture, in the state of Tennessee, and how are our religious rights being attacked by the godless government out there that we have that's bowing down to socialism.
You're 100% on target, and I'm very, very honored to have you on my show today. Of course, and if you're out there listening, you can go back and listen to this again and get all the information on how to keep in contact with the Tennessee Pastors Network and Dale Walker. I really appreciate you coming on. I hope to have you back on again at some point, and we can talk about some of the other issues that you may have and that you're concerned about as well.
My blessed honor to be with you. Thank God for the opportunity to serve in the state of Tennessee, and thank God for the book that we call the Bible,
Amen.
God's holy word. Read it and heed it, because our nation needs it.
Amen. God bless you, brother.
God bless you.
Of course, that was my friend. I call him a friend, and I hope that he continues to be a friend. And, of course, you know, the technology is always in the way, folks. They're using technology against us now. They're now tracking you. They want to track you. They want to trace you. They want to trace your friends. They want to find out what you're doing. They want to find out where you've been. They want to find out where you circle. I wrote a book called The True Manchurian, and part of the plot in the story, and this was, I wrote this in 2010, part of the plot in the story was about how governments were using technology to not only find out what you were doing, but everyone that was in your circle. And that means the circle will just continue to grow. And before long, you had no privacy. You had no freedom. You had no rights to go and practice your religion. You don't have a right to keep and bear arms in some of these institutions and some of these places. How they're stopping you is because of fear, because you're afraid. You're afraid to do what Dale Walker's doing and millions of others out there. You're afraid to go and confront your government. You're afraid to go and stand on the steps of government and tell them that you're not going to tolerate or that you're not going to be subjugated to this nonsense because of a virus, because of these muckety mucks in these lab coats going around telling everybody what they should and shouldn't do and how long you can do it. Now that they're suggesting maybe shutting schools down, public schools like institutions of learning, shutting them down for another year. For a year. Can you imagine that if you shut down all the schools for another year, how parenting is going to change, how daycare for your children will change, how feeding your children will change, how educating your children will change? Guess what? Maybe that's what God is trying to get you to do. Maybe God is trying to wake you up to the fact that it's your responsibility to care for your children. It's your responsibility to educate your children. And it's your responsibility to make sure that your family is protected from whatever may come. And I'm not talking about, you know, going out and having armed insurrection. I'm not calling, but your God-given right to keep and bear arms, and you have a right to do that. You should not be afraid to do that before any government or before any institution. I don't care what the governor in Michigan says. I don't care what the governor in Virginia says. I don't care what the governor of Tennessee says when it comes to my God-given rights. I am going to stand up, and I'm going to fight back. You know, others out there telling us to shut up and don't say anything. Wear your mask. Do this and do that. Well, one time it was don't wear a mask. Then another time it was the mask doesn't help unless you work in an institution like a medical facility. So we've been told all these things back and forth over the years that either we don't have the mask or now we're telling that we don't have to have a mask. Well, now you got to have a mask or you're going to be fine. Of course, I could go on and on about this. This show is designed to wake people up. Facebook and all these places are doing everything they can to keep us from going live. They block us sometime. I have to re-record the show. I have to go on and I have to have other people, you know, get around it and put us on in another way. But we'll get there, even if we have to just continue to share this on my webpage, which is, you can go to imaybewrongbutidontthinkso.com, and you can go to my website. And you can go there and you can get all the podcasts as well on the show. And you can also get us in terms of these re-recorded shows. They're up there on YouTube. And we really thank everyone that has helped us on the program. And no matter who you are, no matter what you do, your voice counts and it matters. And we have to continue to do that. So I want to say God bless you. I want to say God bless America and say God bless our children and peace.
You've been listening to Alfonso Ashworth, the Barry White of Podcast Radio. Go forth and share his message. I may be wrong, but I don't think so. Remember, no two people can ever occupy the same place at the same time. You were uniquely and wonderfully made, born an original. Don't die a copy. God bless. Peace.